If you love ancient history and you want to know more about ancient structures or ancient queens or theories surrounding the ancient world, or you're very interested in human evolution like myself, then I highly suggest you subscribe to the channel and click that bell icon to be notified whenever I upload. And if you like my work, maybe consider becoming a Patreon or a channel member. As we all know, Africa is the cradle of human origins. All human species have their origins in Africa if we go back far enough. But according to a new study published by Nature, it seems that there's a possibility that all living humans on the planet today are the descendants of three populations. These three populations dispersed roughly between 60,000 and 50,000 years ago. A more widespread move happened around this time, when Homo sapiens started moving into places like Eastern Asia, Australia, Europe, and so forth. My name is Kaylee, and in this video, I'm going to look into the new paper that was released in Nature and the possibility that all living humans on the planet today are descendant from African hunter-gatherer tribes. I've covered Homo erectus in the past, the first upright human. You can see the thumbnail right here that spread far and wide over the planet with regional differences, and they interbred, lived quite a long time. If you haven't seen that video yet, then I do suggest clicking the card in the upper right corner so you can learn more, because I mean, why not learn more? But we've also covered Neanderthals, Denisovans, Homo floresiensis, Homo antecessor, and even the new Homo species, as well as Homo sapiens. With this information that I've covered so far since I started creating these videos about human evolution and the human evolutionary timeline, we know that our human story goes back far in time, and the first Homo sapiens emerged around 300,000 years ago in Morocco. But even though the first Homo sapiens emerged that long ago and eventually spread out over the planet, it seems that all modern humans living today have the same source of ancestry going back to just 50,000 years ago. Or at least, that's what some researchers claim. This in itself is quite the statement, to be completely honest with you, to make by researchers. So let's dive into the possibility of this being true. And if so, why? Why do all of us living humans today have our origins in one location not even that long ago? Because in the scope of our human evolutionary timeline, 50,000 years ago, it's not a long time ago. As I just mentioned, the first Homo sapiens emerged in Morocco around 300,000 years ago at the Jebel Irout site. They are the oldest anatomically modern humans, although they still had some archaic features, but they did start to behave in certain ways that we deem modern human. They started to create new stone tools, and it seems that they were the first humans to transport raw materials, most likely through a set of trade networks up to 400 kilometers away, which is approximately 250 miles. We know that they started making clothes at least 140,000 years ago and started to create pierced shell beads to decorate themselves. I mean, why not decorate yourself? But then around 50,000 years ago, they started to create these ostrich eggshell beads, and they exchanged them along a vast distance. So that in itself seems like they did indeed create a trade network. Around this time, the first Homo sapiens had already arrived in Australia and in Europe, and the stone and bone tools became very common wherever Homo sapiens started to inhabit the area. It's a shame that almost all rock art in Africa is undated, and most of it is very, very badly weathered, so that makes dating them even harder. But around 50,000 years ago, there seems to be an increase in ochre pigment at archaeological sites. And this, as you can imagine, hints at an explosion of art. I'll quickly explain a bit about ochre, as my last video apparently left many viewers with a bunch of questions. You can see the thumbnail right here. If you haven't seen that video, you can click on that. So first off, the most asked question was, how many colors of ochre are there? Because most people think that there's just one or two colors. But the answer to that is actually six. There's yellow ochre, red ochre, purple ochre, brown ochre, sienna, and umber. Sienna is darker than the standard yellow ochre, and umber is a dark brown. But when sienna and umber are heated, they turn more reddish in color, and their names then change to burnt sienna and burnt umber. So the oldest uses of ochre dates to approximately 300,000 years ago in Africa. Again, the same time frame as the first Homo sapiens emerged in Morocco. 50,000 years ago in Australia, when the first Homo sapiens arrived in Australia at least. Although that could have been 65,000 years ago, I know. And at least 40,000 years ago in Asia, like we've spoken about in my last video. So yeah, click on that if you haven't seen it. So in Wales, the oldest use of ochre dates from 33,000 years ago, and it was discovered in a Paleolithic burial known as the Red Lady of Paviland. So back to the subject of the video, because if there is high enough demand to know more about ochre, I might just create a short video about it in the future. But I mean, this video isn't about ochre. This video is about, could we all be descendants of the same three tribes? Hunter-gatherers, populations, something like that. The researchers, historians, archaeologists, and paleoanthropologists all know that a shift occurred around 50,000 years ago, as modern humans suddenly spread further and wider, creating these new tools, started transporting materials over vast different distances, and they have dubbed this shift as the later Stone Age transition. But the mystery as to why this shift occurred still stands. Up until the shift, the tools and behaviors were all found across Africa, but not beyond the African continental borders. But after the shift, the behaviors and tools suddenly became widespread and used everywhere, sort of nearly simultaneously. So in order to figure out the mystery, the archaeologists and the paleoanthropologists tried to reconstruct the human behaviors of the past. This is done mainly through the artifacts and remains that have been left behind by these ancient humans. For example, the remains of their meals, their tools, their ornaments, their art, like the cave paintings, and sometimes their fossilized skeletal remains. The problem that we have with reconstructions like these is that it's done over a time span of thousands of years, creating a very broad perspective. And this makes it incredibly difficult to study how different populations changed over time by using the archaeological record alone. So, to try and broaden our understanding, the researchers have decided to use a different approach to research the population changes, and they did this by using DNA research, in combination with evidence from the archaeological record, linguistics, and the use of both oral and written history. As a sort of massive puzzle, with remnants of pieces, they tried to solve the mystery that is the later Stone Age transition. They wanted to piece together how people moved and how they interacted with each other, how they interacted with other tribes in ancient times. And all of this was based on which groups shared genetic similarities. So unfortunately, DNA from living people can't tell us the whole story. Populations have transformed vastly over the past 5,000 years because of the spread of herding and farming, the developments of cities, ancient pandemics, colonialism, slavery, war, and yeah, a lot more. Because a lot happened in the past 5,000 years, don't you think? Because of these reasons, there are lineages of humans that have completely vanished over time, and others have been brought together in later times, forming new populations, and their genetics then merged. But we can't use that to figure out the genetics in ancient times. So to give an example, trying to reconstruct the ancient genetic landscapes by using present-day DNA is sort of like reading a letter that has been left outside in the rain for a while. And there are some words that's you can see that they're still present, but very blurred, and the majority of the letter has just faded completely. So what the researchers need in order to try and solve the mystery is ancient DNA from the human remains that have been found in the archaeological record. And this is needed to explore the human diversity in different places and different times, as this will allow us to understand more about why the shift occurred. Unfortunately, there's one thing that works against the entire idea of researching the ancient DNA. Because even though the oldest ancient DNA ever discovered in Eurasia is 400,000 years old. The oldest ancient DNA from Africa is not older than 9,000 years. This is because the ancient DNA in Africa is degraded due to the heat and the humidity, because the African continent is located around the equator and nearly all circumstances on the entire continent are unsuitable for DNA preservation over longer periods of time, especially beyond 10,000 years. So the team was delighted to be able to use ancient DNA from as old as 18,000 years ago to use in the study, and they worked with DNA up until 400 years old. They used this to explore how people interacted as far back as between 80,000 and 50,000 years ago, because you can make a reconstruction that's a lot more accurate. So this allowed the team, for the very, very first time ever, to test whether demographic change played a factor in the shift known as the later Stone Age transition. So how did they do this? You know, that's the one question we have. So this team sequenced the ancient DNA from six individuals that were found in burials in modern day Tanzania, Malawi, and Zambia. They then compared those sequences with previously studied ancient DNA from 28 individuals that were discovered in burial sites stretching from Ethiopia to Cameroon and all the way down to South Africa. So to say it very simple, burials in an extremely large area of the continent of Africa. For 15 of these 28 individuals, they generated new and improved DNA data analysis to try and extract as much information as possible from the individuals whose DNA was preserved well enough to study. So all of this work created the largest data set that we have up until now for studying the population history of ancient African hunter-gatherers. And this information was then used to explore the population structures that existed prior to the shift, the later Stone Age transition. So what they discovered is that the ancient populations did in fact changed their movements and interactions quite drastically around the later Stone Age transition around 50,000 years ago. Even though some of them were separated by thousands of miles and thousands of years, all the ancient individuals that were used in the research of this study were the descendants of the same three populations of hunter-gatherers. But that's not all. All present-day Eastern, Southern and Central Africans are the descendants of these same three populations of hunter-gatherers as well. The research showed that almost all ancient Eastern Africans shared a very unexpectedly high number of genetic variations with hunter-gatherers who in modern times live in the Central African rainforest. This shows that ancient Eastern Africa truly was a genetic melting pot. So all the mixing and moving of these populations occurred approximately after 50,000 years ago, after the shift, the later Stone Age transition. And for around 30,000 years, they mixed and moved far and wide, having children with people located far away from where they themselves were born, and this mixed their genes. During this time, it is very likely that this mixing and matching and, you know, finding their partners could have happened even outside of the African continent, and therefore their genetic variations traveled far and wide across the globe. But suddenly, around 20,000 years ago, this mixing and merging and traveling along vast distances stopped. They started to find their partners almost exclusively locally. It's unknown as to why the ancient people in Africa suddenly decided to only find their partners locally around 20,000-ish years ago. Although there is a theory that the environmental changes around the last ice age between 26,000 and 11,500 years ago may have been a contributing factor. It's also highly possible that new group identities may have formed and that new marriage structures were developed. And if this is the case, we would see more diversification between the artifacts, the rock art, and the toolmaking in the different regions and locations. And indeed, this diversification is exactly what archaeologists encounter when comparing their finds from different locations, not only in Africa, but in the entire world. And this trend is known as the regionalization. This not only affected the cultural traditions, the creations and exchanges, but we now see that it also affected the flow of the genes. As you can imagine, the ancient DNA research not only answers many questions, but simultaneously also raises at least equally as many new questions. And this study is incredibly important in broadening our understanding, but at the same time, it shows us that there is still so much work to be done. We still do not know what triggered the later Stone Age transition, and this is a mystery that actually might never be solved. But thankfully, we do know that these researchers will try their very best to unravel the mystery. There are still many ancient fossilized remains that have been untouched and not researched yet in museums for at least half a century now. And yeah, they need to be researched soon, because they might play a key in unraveling this ancient mystery. They might be that puzzle piece that we need to further this research. And as for the question that I asked you in the beginning of this video, could every human living on the planet today be a descendant of the ancient African hunter-gatherer tribes from 50,000 years ago? The answer could very possibly actually be yes. But at this point in time, we do not yet have all the evidence that we need to give a definitive yes. More research needs to be done, and only time is capable of revealing the answers to us. DNA research in the past years is making big strides when it comes to the technological advancements, and we keep pushing back the time limits for extracting ancient DNA. But it is very important to remind ourselves that this is only the beginning to understanding ancient DNA and the implications that it has on our understanding of ancient humans. We know this instead of this. This is the start of eventually having a full picture. And as always, I will remain on top of new archaeological news, and I will bring you the questions you never thought of asking yourself, and I'll try and broaden your understanding about the ancient world as time goes on. And if you enjoyed watching, then don't forget to give it a thumbs up, subscribe if you'd like to see more of these kind of videos, and click that bell icon if you want to be notified whenever I upload. If you haven't seen my previous videos yet, then click the card in the upper right corner, or click a link in the description down below, or click a video in the end card. I cater to you. It's always set to best for viewer. And I would like to thank my channel members and my patrons for all your support of me, and I'm eternally grateful for it. I made some bloopers in this video. They weren't great. I got a new outfit. I like it. I'm very happy. I think I've blabbed enough now. See you in the next one. Bye. Transport raw material. Tanzania, Malawi, and Zambia.